All right, good morning, guys. Welcome. Thanks for watching Fox 5 Live. I'm Molly Nevola here in DC. You are watching live. We're here in our Washington, DC newsroom. You can see behind me, kind of a little dark there today. They're testing out some lights. But we are here to bring you live and breaking news as it happens. We're going to throw you around Capitol Hill today a little bit with some of the scene there. Some interesting hearings going on about the Russia investigations, of course. Nancy Pelosi is currently in the middle of delivering her weekly address as we speak. I want to give you a quick update first on the situation that we had yesterday. We had a breaking news situation on Capitol Hill. If you were watching, we tried to bring you all those live pictures of what was going on with a purported erratic driver. It was a female suspect who was stopped by police after they believe she was trying to hit a police cruiser, possibly was trying to run one over. That's what we heard reports of. They found out the ultimate news now that we have is that they identified the suspect. She is 20-year-old Talia Everett. She was charged with 7 counts of assault on a police officer, 2 counts of destruction of property, fleeing, leaving after colliding, and having no valid permit. So some information coming out about this 20-year-old woman who was involved in that incident yesterday that we brought you live. If we have any more information that comes out of that, we'll obviously bring it to you. But yeah, for now, you're just watching live. We're going to show you what is going on today, some behind the scenes of stuff that we will be covering later in some of our evening shows. And any information that comes into us, just that you can be privy to what's going on midday here in DC and around the nation. So right now, some interesting things happening on Capitol Hill. Of course, these big hearings and things happen during the day, so we don't get to bring them to you on our morning shows, on our evening shows. So right here is where you can stream them. I guess first we're gonna go over to the Senate. There's currently a Senate hearing on the Russia investigations. This has been sort of an ongoing thing, as you probably know, for the past few days, past week. We'll hear some interesting statements there, and once it gets sort of stagnant, we'll switch it out, bring you something else live. Also hoping to have a special guest in the studio today, so keep watching for more. Here is the Senate currently live.
Special insights here, you know, I feed off the same reporting that's appeared in the papers. I would be careful to describe all Russian oligarchs and oligarch itself as a fairly ill-defined term. There's sort of a handful of some of those prominent ones, but it's a much bigger class of major Russian businessmen. I would be reluctant to describe them all as, tools of the Kremlin. Obviously, Russian businessmen who do business in Russia have to be mindful of Kremlin political preferences, and the Kremlin has considerable influence over them. But I can't speak from concrete information about them being, directly instruments of the Kremlin foreign policy. That's not something that I have evidence to back up. I think I'll stop at that.
Okay, Mr. Watts. One of the things that your testimony, I've been talking a lot about the use of the internet trolls and their ability to then exponentially gain more power through creating these botnets. I'd love you to kind of comment about what we can do to preclude that on a going forward basis, and perhaps you can explain this technique better than I have in my various public statements.
Sure. The first thing that I think we need to understand is it's not all automated and it's not all human. There's a combination of the two. So you have a series of humans that work in their psychological warfare groups that command both bots at the same time, and I like to, as an analogy, you can look at it like artillery. So you have someone who's engaging with you as an individual, and at the same time, they can launch a bot to amplify that story forward. When we watch,
obviously the bot for those ability for a computer to take over other computers that are not being used and in effect magnify the number of hits they might hit to a particular social media site, correct?
Exactly. Or you can create more personas in Twitter, for example, which makes it look like there are more people than there really are. It's a Potemkin village strategy, essentially, that amplifies your appearance. So what they do is they launch those simultaneously as they begin the engagement or push of false news stories, usually from RT and Sputnik News. They do that in unison, which games the social media system such that such a high volume of content being pushed at the same time raises that into the trends that you'll see. If you looked at Facebook or Twitter or whatever it might be, you'd see the top 10 stories that are out right now. It pushes that up there. As soon as it pushes that into that top 10 feed, mainstream media outlets then are watching that and they start to examine that content. So for example, the Interlink attack I talked about, one of the key hashtags they pushed is media. The goal is to get that into the top of Twitter stream so that mainstream media has to respond to that story. When mainstream media responds to it or just looks at it without even commenting on it, it takes over organically and you'll see it move around the internet like a virus.
One thing, and I'm gonna spend a lot of time on this afternoon, there have been reports that their ability to target this information, some reports at least saying that in the last week of the campaign in certain precincts in Wisconsin, Michigan, Pennsylvania, there was so much misinformation coming, talking about Hillary Clinton's illnesses or Hillary Clinton stealing money from the State Department or other, that completely blanked out any of the back and forth that was actually going on in the campaign. One of the things that seems curious is, would the Russians on their own have that level of sophisticated knowledge about the American political system if they didn't at least get some advice from someone in the—
And guys, I'm just gonna cut in right here. We actually currently have a cool event going on that one of our photographers is at, and he's bringing it back live. House Democrats, led by Representative Don Beyer, are meeting to discuss immigration enforcement and a bill that would be proposed to prohibit that immigration enforcement in sensitive locations like schools, hospitals, places of worship, and courthouses. I'm gonna bring you that presser live right now. We're gonna jump over there.
Across the country, tearing apart families does not make our communities safer. A great country does not tear apart families, take parents from their children, or deport students who have grown up in this country. We don't terrify newcomers, and we do not deport long-standing community members. We are better than that as a nation. So thank you again, Representative, for partnering with me on this important legislation. And I'm honored to introduce another great colleague, Representative Serrano from New York.
Thank you so much. My colleagues have presented this in a very good way, proper way. Here's the thing that we have to understand. There are already regulations and rules, if you will, that prohibit this behavior. But as we all know, in this society, in all societies, people break rules all the time. So what this bill says, it takes those rules and puts them into law and says you can't do this. Now picture this. A lot of the information we get, in all honesty, we get from people who come to our offices or see us on the street and talk to us. And unless there's a great conspiracy of everybody making these stories up, these are true stories. For instance, we've heard of parents who are afraid to take their children to the school bus because in dropping the child off, they may get picked up by ICE and deported when ICE is not supposed to be there. Then there's a question that some people may say, Serrano, you're overstating the issue, you're being melodramatic. But do we want to now reach a situation where a parish, there's so many parishes that I know, Catholic Church, Evangelical Church, in my district, and now all of a sudden that attendance on Sundays will go down and down and down because there have been rumors and few sightings of ICE agents outside. In fact, I can't tell you this for a fact, but I have information that outside the building where my district office is located, there was ICE agents. Now, there are other sensitive offices, if you will, in that building, but were they waiting to look for people who come to my office to get information on their immigration status? I don't know. So what this does today, and why I think our colleagues have been great, is to say you already have certain behavior that you're supposed to abide by. Well, you know, you're not doing that, so we're going to make it into law. Lo que estamos haciendo en el día de hoy es simplemente diciendo que existe el reglamento por el cual ICE tiene que comprometerse. Pero ICE, como bien sabemos, es una agencia que la mayor parte del tiempo no dice la verdad. Y si usted le pregunta a ellos dónde estaban buscando indocumentados, le van a decir que ellos nunca buscan indocumentados, que solamente lo hacen cuando tienen que hacerlo. Pero hay información que tenemos de iglesias, de supermercados, de los llamados food pantries, donde personas van a buscar alimentos, de escuelas, de hospitales, de cortes, donde no hay esa protección. Y lo que estamos diciendo es que ustedes tienen el reglamento, ahora queremos que esos reglamentos se conviertan en ley para prohibirle a ustedes intimidar a nuestra comunidad. I want to end with this. We have an immigration issue in this country. I don't call it a problem because people coming for a better life is never a problem. We have an immigration issue. We will eventually resolve that issue. But until then, people should be allowed to worship, should be allowed to go to a hospital, should be allowed to go to a restaurant, should be allowed to go to school, should be allowed to go to work. We should not interfere with that. Thank you so much. And now, every member of Congress has two places where they spend a lot of time at. One is in their home district, and one is in their Washington area. And so my congressman locally is the next speaker, Don Beyer, from Arlington, Northern Virginia.
Thank you, Mr. Serrano. I've been trying to get Mr. Serrano to vote for me. You were here for a very important reason. In every one of our districts, especially those of us who have significant percentages of people who were born overseas, in our very wealthy, very well-educated Northern Virginia district just across the river, 37% of the homes speak a language other than English in their home. So what the recent immigration actions have done is create this incredible culture of fear. And these are people, not just people without papers, without documents, but people that are here on green cards, people that are here that are citizens who were born someplace else. The fear is pervasive. And there is an old DHS memo that says ICE will respect sensitive locations, churches, schools, funerals, things like that. But we know, case by case, individual cases, where ICE has ignored the DHS memo. And that's why I'm so glad that Congressman Espaillat has put this together to formalize the respect for the sensitive places. In Northern Virginia, for us, it was the ICE gathering up of homeless people coming out of a hypothermia schedule down on Route 1 in Fairfax. They came out, they picked up seven of them as they exited the place. And this was a church, Rising Hope Church. Apparently they released a couple of them later. Some of them just disappeared into the network. This is wrong. Our country was built on compassion and humanity and respect for all people. I look here at the incredible genetic diversity of the folks who are attending this press conference. This is what makes America strong. And when we overreact on immigration, in the wake of years of failure of Congress to pass comprehensive immigration reform, the last thing we need is an over-aggressive, over-rambunctious, over-robust ICE organization disrespecting our sensitive areas. And I'm so glad to be a small part of this effort to move it forward. Let me give you back to our chief sponsor. Thank you.
Thank you, Congressman. Again, this is sensible legislation. We met with General Kelly, and he said, he would not object to the body camera bill, that we needed to get the funding. And so we're looking to go to appropriations to see how we get the funding. And then he said that his agents were not engaged in surveilling or arresting people outside these very sensitive locations. So we just wanted to codify that and ensure that it is in the body of laws that would make it illegal for any ICE agents to engage in this type of practice. And that's why we submitted this legislation today. So now I open it up to questions. Yes.
Yesterday, several of us had the chance to talk to the spokesman of Secretary Kelly. He met with the mayors, the Conference of Mayors, and the Association of Chiefs of Police. And he told us, the spokesman told us, something that you repeated today, that they have said before, that they do not go to schools, that they do not hang out outside churches. And he acknowledged that they do arrest people at courthouses because he said that they feel, ICE agents, that that is a safe environment for them and for everybody else to make those arrests. Do you think that they're lying? I mean, after
all, let me just say to you that as we were having the meeting with General Kelly, Congressman Lou Correa from California brought forward a video, a photograph of a nice vehicle on a church ground. And it was up on the screen exactly as he was saying that his agents do not engage in that type of practice. So this has been the disparity, right? The Homeland Security says one thing and our constituents are saying another. And so we want to make sure that ICE agents adhere to the letter of the law, and there's no better way than having to codify what is already an internal memo into law. And so this is what we're doing. Now, there are dozens of cases that have been reported to us, and I'm sure there's hundreds of cases out there that have not been reported to us, but we've heard of one case right here outside of a shelter that is a church. So this is a twofer, if you may. A shelter, right? A housing program for the homeless, but that is also a house of worship. And an ICE agents were outside of it making multiple arrests. And so this is not a hidden secret anymore. We know that it is a common practice that violates an internal regulation that we want to codify as law today.
Se lo pregunto en español, ¿están mintiendo?
Yo creo que sí, que están mintiendo.
Can I just add on to that? The concern that I have about courthouses is that if we want people to report crimes or to testify against a perpetrator, they need to be safe in a courthouse. And so that's my concern. I was there when Secretary Kelly said that a courthouse is a safe place to arrest people. But if we can't have people feeling safe reporting crimes or testifying, we're going to have a criminal justice system that lets perpetrators go free. And that's my concern.
Or seeking protective orders.
Correct. Exactly.
Any other questions? Otra preguntas?
Cuando los legisladores buscan proteger a los habitantes de un país en contra de las investidas de su gobierno, ¿quiere decir que hay algo mal en el país de la libertad?
Yo creo que hay algo mal en el gobierno. Los gobiernos no son perfectos. En ningún tiempo de la historia nuestra el gobierno de este país ha sido perfecto. Por tal razón, la legislatura ha tenido que amendar las leyes, crear nuevas leyes para traer un sentido de justicia en la sociedad. Y estamos precisamente en ese momento hoy, donde la vigilancia, el arresto, la interrogación de personas no deben de ser conducida por agentes de ICE en localizaciones sensitivas como iglesias, hospitales y también en otras áreas donde la familia debe tener un sentido de privacidad, en las mismas cortes también, en centros de salud, en escuelas, no debe suceder eso.
Quiero añadir algo si es posible. Quiero añadir algo si es posible. Alguien va a decir, quizá uno de ustedes lo está pensando, quizá la gente que va a la oficina de Serrano, español, nosotros, están haciendo historia, inventando algo. Si conocemos el comportamiento del indocumentado, el que está aquí en una situación débil, el comportamiento siempre es esconderse de la sociedad. Ellos no ganan nada. Salir en público, ir a la oficina de un congresista y decir, ahí se está en el vecindario, o ahí se está en la escuela, o está en un hospital. O sea, ellos no ganan nada con eso. Por eso yo creo lo que ellos me están diciendo a mí y lo que se está diciendo en mi comunidad.
¿Cuántos sponsors so far?
Tenemos 24 co-auspiciadores de la IA. We have 24 co-sponsors of the bill as of today.
How do you ensure that?
¿Cómo?
Republican.
Hasta ahora no, pero yo estoy seguro. Nayer, pero yo estoy seguro que hay republicanos que también van a encontrar este proyecto de ley atractivo para ellos.
How do you ensure that people don't redefine that a church is basically they make a church to make sure that ICE agents aren't able to get in there? How do you qualify that where these locations would be are in fact legitimate?
Right. I certainly think that's not going to be an issue to have an established church. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it, but that my concern right now is making sure that people feel safe when they go to worship, when they access health care, when they're taking their kids to school. And if that's a problem, that can be worked out.
Were to claim that their house is a small church or a place of worship, that would count.
And I'm not concerned about that. We can cross that bridge when we come to it. Right now, we need to
know. As Shakespeare said, a church is a church by any other name. Okay,
you can refer back to
that. Besides, that's covered by other issues. You know.
Yeah, right. There will be, right. I am
there,
sure,
there are ways to
there's a legal
that.
Framework to go to that will establish exactly what a church
right.
is.
Like yeah. a so, tax code, for
so
example.
So this could be too soon, but what kind of reception have you gotten from Republican lawmakers? And in Espanol, ¿qué tipo de reacción ha tenido hasta ahorita? ¿Qué han dicho los legisladores republicanos?
Well, look, I think this is, first of all, Kelly has said that this is already a practice within the Department of Homeland Security. So this is not something so out there, so radical, that anybody should run away from. Second, I think any sensible American will feel for somebody that's going to a funeral of one of their loved ones, and that that person should not be afraid that when they go outside the funeral, after grieving for their mother or father, grandfather, grandmother, or spouse, that they should have to confront an ICE agent interrogating them, arresting them, and eventually deporting them. So this is a very practical and sensible piece of legislation that any American should feel comfortable with. Yo creo que esta es una pieza de legislación que cualquier americano se debe sentir cómodo en apoyar. ¿Cómo es que una persona va a entrar a un funeral? ¿Cómo es que una persona va a entrar a una iglesia, a una escuela? Y entonces afuera tendrá que enfrentar a un agente de ICE que lo va a interrogar, arrestar y deportar. Yo creo que todos los americanos, tanto demócratas como republicanos, se pueden identificar con este proyecto de ley.
And I'll add too that, and thank you, Representative, but this bill was introduced today and we'll be working to get bipartisan co-sponsorships. But when you really focus on that, number one, this is an existing guidance that we want to codify, but also to put into law, but also that this is designed to make our community safer. When people are not able to report crimes because they're afraid to go to the courthouse, when they can't get a protective order, that is not making our community safer. This will make our community safer, and I hope that that can help us build support.
I'm not asking about maybe Speaker Ryan may think differently, but obviously Republicans on the Judiciary and Immigration Subcommittees just held hearings about how enforcement has been so lax in the last 2 years, and they want more enforcement. Do you expect anything to come out of there, or any support to come out of there? But their ideas are totally different.
Well, go ahead.
Well, they may consider enforcement to be lax as it pertains to Border Patrol, or they may consider enforcement to be lax as it pertains to the number of ICE agents or even the budget that was assigned to Homeland Security. But I don't think they will go as far as to think that surveilling St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York is appropriate. On Sunday, I'm sure that Cardinal Dolan will have something to say about that. And so, everyone, I think, could be reasonable and practical. And even those that may want more enforcement to understand that these very important, sensitive locations should be protected.
Should be humane enforcement.
That's a wrap, everyone. You have one more question? Yeah. Last question.
All right, guys, we're going to slowly take you out of this live press conference. Like we said, Representative Don Beyer meeting with other House Democrats as well on this immigration bill that they are proposing. And it would introduce a bill that would prohibit immigration enforcement in sensitive locations and spots like schools, churches, et cetera. You heard him mention or quoting Shakespeare and throwing in the word church instead of rose. Thought that was pretty interesting. That's happening right now live. And our photog, Jason Smith, is getting that back for us. I'm going to jump it over now to another event that's happening live. Speaker Paul Ryan is giving his weekly media address. Might be some interesting tidbits in here. Let's jump on over to that.
Just to pass this bill, but it's very understandable that the president is frustrated that we haven't gotten to where we need to go, because this is something we all said we would do. And so he is just expressing his frustration. You all know that he does that in various forms, including Twitter. And I understand his frustration.
The Senate today is moving forward with their Russia investigation, exposing the real immediate danger that Russia poses to America's democracy. While the House committee seems to be bogged down in politics, focusing more on the president's tweets, yeah. Is the House committee missing the big picture here?
I want the House committee to have a full and thorough and bipartisan investigation. Get everything out there, follow the facts wherever they go, and get to the truth. That's going to take some time, and I'm confident they're going to do that. I think you're right, this has gotten a little political. Let's take a pause, and let's just get all the evidence, all the documents, and find out what happened. And what I'm worried about with Russia is, you've got elections coming online in Europe, you know, this year. And so the Russians clearly are trying to meddle in other countries' elections. We have to help our allies prevent that from happening and uncover it. We have to find out what they try to do here. We've got to make sure we get to the bottom of that and wherever the facts go. But then we also, in my opinion, need to do more to help our allies guard against this invasion into their democracy from Russia. Juan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. A number of Republicans I spoke to this week said that you need the $880 billion from Medicaid savings from the health care bill in order to lower the revenue baseline and achieve significant corporate tax.
It's the other way around. It's not the Medicaid. It's the revenue. It's the, you know how this works, Juan. You're a budget guy.
Do you agree that there is a direct correlation between the Medicaid?
No, there is not a direct correlation. That's not correct. So somebody's misunderstanding how baselines work around here. The Medicaid savings, the spending baseline, has nothing to do with tax reform. It's the revenue baseline. It's the Obamacare taxes that themselves affect tax reform. Here's the way the math works. If we repeal the Obamacare taxes, then that is a revenue baseline that we don't have to put into tax reform. If we don't repeal the Obamacare taxes, it is my position that we're just going to leave those taxes over there with Obamacare and reform the rest of the IRS tax code. But it does make tax reform harder. It's all about the revenue baseline. It has nothing to do with the spending baseline. Chad.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, explain this idea of not wanting the president to work with Democrats on the health care here, but also when, you know, some of us just talked to Chris Collins, you know, a big Trump ally, and he says, you know, the next time that the Freedom Caucus calls the Tuesday group, we should hang up the phone. He says we're not going to hit health care again until 2019. You say we're close. Why should anyone believe it?
Well, because about 90% of our conference is there. And about 10%.
But 90% doesn't get you there if you're doing it.
That's exactly right. But what 95 does. So that's why I say we're close, because we are. Here's the point I'm making here. The Democrats aren't for repealing Obamacare. We are. We work with Democrats all the time. I mean, look, Patty Murray and I did a big budget agreement. I mean, so we have long histories of working with Democrats. But I don't think it's a stretch of the mind to suggest that the Democrats disagree with us on repealing Obamacare. They're not going to help us repeal Obamacare. That's my point. And so if we're going to do what we said we would do, which is repeal and replace Obamacare and save the American healthcare system, something tells me the Democrats aren't going to help us repeal Obamacare. They're the ones who created it in the first place.
Yeah. Mr. Speaker, on fiscal 17, will you send an 11-bill omnibus to the House? Will it fund the wall, and will it contain...
The bill hasn't been completed yet. The appropriators are still negotiating, so it's premature to get into the contents of the bill. We've already done DOD, so there's 11 other bills that we would pass. The question is it one bill, two bills? I think that's one for the Senate to decide how they're going to package the bill. It's really about kind of their calendar and how they work. But our goal is to work on the rest of the bills, and that's what our appropriators are negotiating. Those negotiations aren't done, so it'd be premature to get into the contents.
Senate
of the
leaders
bills.
Think that you're going to send them a spending wrap-up. Is that?
Yeah, I think that's right. We've already sent them DOD, and I anticipate we'll send them the rest.
How should House Republicans approach their lawsuit on the Affordable Care Act, given that the law remains in place? Would taking those cost-sharing reductions away destabilize the market?
Well, yes, and you're right over there? Man, that didn't sound so good. yes, I think the answer is yes on your last part, but the lawsuit's going to take some time. This is a separation of powers issue, and I don't know when the lawsuit's going to get wrapped up. This I think it goes into May. If we end up going to court, That could take us months. So it's just currently an unresolved.
If the payments should be continued and the Trump administration.
While the lawsuit is being litigated, then the administration funds these benefits. That's how they've been doing it, and I don't see any change in that.
Sir, to follow up on that, you just said that this $7 billion, I think this would destabilize the markets if this lawsuit is successful. So why not drop the lawsuit, or why not work with the administration?
Well, we don't want to drop the lawsuit because we believe in the separation of powers. We believe in Congress retaining its lawmaking power. But this lawsuit hasn't run its full course. While this lawsuit is running its course, the administration is exercising their discretion with respect to CSRs. Our plan A here is to repeal and replace Obamacare and have that transition occur where these markets are stabilized, and that's what we hope to achieve.
Last question.
So the health bill seems to be a little bit in limbo, and you're encouraging members to talk to each other. Will you commit that there will be another vote on this bill or a similar bill?
I'm not going to commit to when and what the vote's going to look like, because it's my job to help make sure that House Republicans can coalesce and come together and draw consensus. What I'm encouraging our members to do is figure out what solutions get us to a bill that everybody can vote for and pass. That's the kind of conversations that are occurring. This is too big of an issue to not get right. And so I'm not going to put some kind of artificial deadline on saving the American healthcare system from an oncoming collapse. I just think it's too important. Let's forget about all the Beltway talk here and think about there are families that are hurting. There are families that aren't getting the kind of health care they need. Premiums are going up double digits. Plans are pulling out of marketplaces. No one has a choice in about a third of American counties. This is a problem. And the actuaries of the insurance companies are telling us it's just going to get worse. So it's really important that we do something to fix this problem. And that's going to take us to continue to work to get consensus. And I'm not going to put a timeline on it because I just want to make sure that we get this done right. Thank you very much, everybody. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, we'll bring you right back here. Thanks for watching, guys. You're watching Fox 5 Live. We are live in Washington, D.C. Check out our handle, Fox 5 D.C. That's our handle on all social media platforms. Please do follow us. You can always get at me here on our YouTube stream using the chat box that you see on the right side. Follow us on Facebook and Snapchat and Instagram as well, and use that hashtag to alert me so I can see what you want to talk about, what you guys are thinking about. Today, we'll push it over now. I'm trying to see what else we have coming in to the Senate floor one more time. We still have an ongoing feed of a hearing there, and we're still waiting for some special guests to come visit me if that does happen today. But rocking and rolling along, just giving you the live events on Capitol Hill and in D.C. and across the nation as well. So jumping over to the Senate hearing on the Russia investigations. There's a look inside.
A public statement just hours ago saying, "Watch my lips." No. And then followed up with, "All these things are fictional, illusory, provocations, lies, used for domestic American political agendas. The anti-Russian card is played by different political forces inside the United States to trade on and consolidate their positions inside." Well, he certainly consolidated us. It is painful to watch the Russian people trapped in a regime that is doing this worldwide. They'd like to be able to watch the Olympics and know their athletes weren't doped ahead of time. They would like to believe their own news when the Russians proclaim, "We're not in Ukraine and we're not in Syria," and they are. And it'd be nice if we could, as he said, "Watch my lips," and know that he's not trying to deceive our audiences. My question is, first, why did he think he could get away with it this time? This is not new for the Russians. They've done this for a long time across Europe, but it was much more engaging this time in our election. Why now? Mr. Watson?
I think this answer is very simple and is what no one is really saying in this room, which is, part of the reason active measures have worked in this U.S. election is because the commander-in-chief has used Russian active measures at time against his opponents. On 14 August 2016, his campaign chairman, after a debunked insert...
When you say his, who's his?
Paul Manafort. Cited the fake Interlake story as a terrorist attack on CNN, and he used it as a talking point. On 11 October, President Trump stood on a stage and cited a what appears to be a fake news story from Sputnik News that disappeared from the internet. He denies the intel from the United States about Russia. He claimed that the election could be rigged. That was the number one theme pushed by RT, Sputnik News, white outlets all the way up until the election. He's made claims of voter fraud, that President Obama is not a citizen, that, you know, Congressman Cruz is not a citizen. So part of the reason active measures works, and it does today in terms of Trump Tower being wiretapped, is because they parrot the same lines. So Putin is correct. He can say that he's not influencing anything because he's just putting out his stance. But until we get a firm basis on fact and fiction in our own country, get some agreement about the facts, whether it be do I support the intelligence community or a story I read on my Twitter feed, we're going to have a big problem. I can tell you right now today, gray outlets that are Soviet pushing accounts tweet at President Trump during high volumes when they know he's online and they push conspiracy theories. So if he is to click on one of those or cite one of those, it just proves Putin correct, that we can use this as a lever against the Americans.
So this started in 2008-9 time period, as you've cited before with your previous timeline. Even before this rose up, even when there were 16 Republican candidates on the stage, this was a long time coming, and it seemed to be very well organized this time. Part of my question is, I get that completely. Why this time? They look to be more prepared. Probing, evaluating states, trying to get into voter records, trying to be more active in the process.
They have plausible deniability. If you wanted to run this during the Cold War, you would have had to put agents inside the United States. They would have been stalked by counterintelligence professionals. They would have been run down. You couldn't have gained an audience on a communist newspaper, for example. Today, you can create the content, gain the audience, build the bots, pick out the election and even the voters that are valued the most in swing states and actually insert the right content in a deliberate period. They pre-planned it. They were based a year and a half out. They're doing it today on the European elections. And here's the other thing that needs to come up. They try all messages. You know, we've been very focused on, you know, our presidential election. The Republicans, you know, tend to come up. But the Democrats, they were there too. They were with Bernie Sanders supporters trying to influence them in different directions. So they play all sides. They, much like I learned in infantry school about how they use artillery, they fire artillery everywhere, and once they get a break in the wall, that's where they swarm in and they focus. And they do that very well today. You'll see them in Europe supporting people on the left or right, whichever will dismantle the democratic function that they're after. So I think the important point moving forward is we have to educate our public and even our institutions. And the mainstream media is right to be taking some on the chin right now. They've fallen for a lot of these fake news stories. They've amplified it, and they've not gone back and done good fact-checking. The media needs to improve. Our U.S. government institutions need to improve. And we got to help Americans understand what the facts are. Because if we don't, we are lost. We will become two separate, maybe three separate worlds in the United States just because of this little bitty pinprick that was put in by a foreign country.
Which is their goal on that, Mr. Chairman Ivak?
Senator Manchin.
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much. I want to thank Senator King for allowing me. I have another meeting I've got to attend, but I wanted to ask this question. I've been around long enough to remember that my school desk at home protected me if I jumped underneath of it, held my head during the nuclear attack from Russia. I'm not sure that my United States Senate desk, if I jump underneath of it and hold my head, will protect me this time. And that's putting it mildly. With that being said, much has been written about the new hybrid style of warfare practiced by the Russians recently in Georgia, Crimea, and Ukraine. To be brief, Russia believes the lines between war and peace are blurred. Wars are no longer declared and no longer fought in a traditional manner. And the power of non-military means to achieve objectives exceeds the power of weapons and effectiveness. Some label it the Gerasimov doctrine, which is a combination of political, military, economic, social, and media means to achieve Russian strategic objectives. In the United States, we would call this a whole of government approach. So my question would be to any of you, and I'll start with you, Mr. Watts, if possible, is Russia's meddling in our 2016 elections proof The United States is dealing with a nation that is acting in its own warlike manner.
Yes. Would you like me to comment on some of the things
Please.
We can do? Yeah, so there are seven or eight things we could do immediately that are not very complicated.
And my desk is not going to save me this time, right?
No, and I'll tell you right now, I'm going to walk out of here today. I'm going to be cyber attacked. I'm going to be discredited by trolls. You know, my biggest fear isn't being on Putin's hit list or psychological warfare targeting. I've been doing that for 2 years. My biggest concern right now is I don't know what the American stance is on Russia and who's going to take care of me. I mean, after years in the Army and the FBI, working in the intel communities today, I'm going to walk out of here and ain't nobody going to be covering my back. I'm going to be on my own. And so that's very disconcerting. And I think that speaks to what we need to do. One, in terms of falsehoods, we need to do two things. We need a State Department and a DHS website that immediately refute when falsehoods are put out. These seem silly when they come out. Incirlik terrorist attack, for example. But the quicker they're refuted, the faster they die in social media. We caught the Incirlik attack because it was refuted quickly. When the Russians fake it, it gets exposed. If it goes on too long, it gets into mainstream media and it runs out of control. The other part is the FBI. They're doing a great job in terms of investigating hacking, but the hacking powers influence. Whenever there's a hack, we should immediately go in and look at what was stolen and figure out what is the anticipated smear campaign discrediting, how is this going to be weaponized and influenced. The next one I think is super important, which is educating U.S. businesses. Treasury and Commerce right now need to be doing awareness campaigns. Their companies suffer smear campaigns from foreign countries right now, which change their stock prices. Their employees are in social media and are being picked off through social engineering and hacked at. The other part really is in the private sector and the public sector that we need to look at. Mainstream media companies, we need to be working with them. What if they boycotted WikiLeaks collectively? What if they all didn't race to publish too quickly? If those damaging, stolen information that is misconstrued oftentimes doesn't get into the mainstream media, if all of them block it out, Russia's influence dies on the vine. And the last thing I think is the social media companies. Whether we like it or not, social media has become the news provider for almost all Americans. Our preferences shape what we see, and our friends share stuff with us, and it reinforces our views. And so I think that for them, they're worried about the state.
All right, guys, going to take you out of that for now, that you're watching the Senate hearing on the Russian investigations. That's going on live right now on Capitol Hill. I want to bring you something else that's really interesting. I find space stuff to be super cool, and anything from NASA is really interesting. And today, they are performing their 199th International Space Station spacewalk. So this is Expedition 50. So there's been a series of these. Basically, they float up about 250 miles up to the International Space Station, these astronauts, and they perform, you know, checks and install things and make it usable for the next kind of mission and stuff like that. The interesting thing about this one, and we're going to try to bring you this footage live, NASA gives their multimedia out so we can use this, their government thing. So the cool thing about today is that it's two people, Shane Kimbo and Peggy Whitson. And Peggy is about to become the world's most experienced female space walker. So I think after this expedition, she'll just be behind two other astronauts, a Russian and an American, for the length of time that she spent up there, the number of hours. I'm trying to bring you some more stats here. Yeah, she'll move up to number 3 of the world's most experienced spacewalkers with a total time of about 59 hours, trailing only a Russian cosmonaut and a former astronaut, Mike Lopez Alegria, who have 68 and 67 hours of time. So let's go over to this footage here as these astronauts begin expedition number 50. Let me see this for you. And we'll get their footage. And this is coming from the Space Center in Houston. So you might hear some talk over, some reporting on that. But let me just bring you over there because it's pretty interesting stuff.
I think I've got the tether point tethered. If it was the first one from clockwise around from the notch, then I've got it.
That's perfect. It should be 90 degrees clockwise from the notch. So with that, you can tighten that AET down.
Yeah.
And you can tighten it as much as it can go.
All right, so I'm holding. Are you on tag or what?
No, we're. I've got it here. Tethered to the handrail. I have a question about our orientation. That's going to be asked.
I don't see an adjustable. You put one on here? Or
no, I had one on me. Do you have any extra?
Yeah, I do. Where do I need to put it in?
Okay, the other AET is going to go directly opposite of where Peggy just put that one on. So it's going to be at the 9 o'clock position on the shield, directly opposite of her. There are also the Velcro straps around the circumference of the shield. You're welcome to use those to temporarily hold down the cover while we get the AETs in. We will end up tacking those down and tighten them to keep it secure at the end.
Alright.
And Shane, we expect that if you're moving down to do that AET opposite of where Peggy is, we do expect that to connect to one of the handholds on a shield. And if you're translating down forward,
so we'll track it down as we go around, otherwise.
Copy. And that's fine. And also be aware of the tether routing, Shane, if you're coming down forward and Nader, Peggy, his tether from his green hook may cross your worksite.
Okay. Well, Peg, I'm just holding on to one of these straps right now. It's kind of stabilizing it for you, I guess. Where are you?
All right, guys, jumping on in here, we have a little bit of a cool scenario going on right now in Miami, Florida. We're getting in some aerials of an alligator capture. This is pretty cool. I'm going to jump over here, see if there's any audio for you. Doesn't look like it, but we'll keep it on here because it's kind of some interesting footage. All right, it looks like possibly that chopper is leaving the area for those aerials. We'll see if he goes back. Oh, he's just retracting and coming back in. Kind of a cool sight. I don't know too much about alligator captures, but some of you guys out there who maybe are watching in Florida or know what it's like to be around these reptiles might know a little more. That looks like a really big one. Let you take a watch on this for a little bit, and then we'll jump it back. Hey guys, just checking back in. It's Molly here. Thank you, Jordan, for connecting with us on YouTube chat. I see you up there. I also wish Steve Irwin were still alive. He would definitely know what to do. Looks like our chopper is heading back out again. And I guess that is a pretty large one. I actually don't really know the difference between an alligator and a crocodile. The closest I ever came, I was in the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico. And I was swimming in a cenotes. It's one of those like kind of like secluded still water lake things that you kind of swim in. And my friend who I was with thought he saw one. And so we immediately like left the scene and stopped swimming. And it was murky and scary. And that was the closest I came to possibly being near one. But I really am so unfamiliar with this stuff. So if you guys have any more information, if you want to chat it up, feel free to connect with us here. But yeah, we'll just see if we get any more footage of this, and then we'll roll on out to something else. Yeah, and I guess this is a normal thing anyway for, you know, Floridians and Florida residents and people near the Everglades and all those sort of areas. But I guess to people who are foreign to it, it's pretty frightening. I mean, it's probably frightening anyway. But yeah, it seems like we're rolling out of this chopper footage. But that's a pretty interesting thing they caught on camera. It's nice when we get sent those aerials because it's fascinating stuff that you just really don't see, you know, up here. I'm in Washington, D.C. You know, I've grew up in New England, like on the coast, and it's not the same as being sort of in that southeast area and deeper into, you know, Everglades Park and down into Mexico and all those things. So totally different region up here. But it looks like we're seeing, oh, they do have some crews there. It's kind of cool to see the news crews getting this, running to the scene to get this footage. I guess it's a surprisingly big one or something interesting about it. And we'll stay on this for a little longer. Thanks for commenting, guys.
they're in the wrong, they're in the that water that they are, right there. Tell them to stop. If they look all the way back to their...
All right, so we're getting a little coverage. We can hear some reporter or something, and it's going to be a little static, but I'm going to put this up because it might give us some more information.
So tell them to go straight ahead and make the first right. You have to go out to the main drag. Go straight ahead all the way to the as far as they can go, and then make a right. No.
All right, it's possibly just chatter about directions of the chopper, but thanks so much, guys, for engaging with us. Thanks, Jordan, for chatting. We love hearing what you have to say and what you think about the feed and the aerials that you're seeing. So stick with us. We're going to keep it on just interesting stuff that we have gathered that's happening now in this moment live during your Thursday afternoon. So stay with us.
Make the next right. Next right.
All right, guys, looks like we are out of that feed. Going to bring it back to NASA for you.
So I can use the Velcro strap on the ones that are loose. If that works for you.
Yeah, there's one that won't reach, so I'm going to have to do it around the
shorter one. Yeah, I'm in wrap multiple times. That's what I did.
Shane, as you work around, you can release the bagrette from the PMA-3 cover when you get there.
All right, once again, guys, you're watching live coverage from NASA. You can see sort of at the lower third of your screen, this is ISS, International Space Station Expedition 50. And essentially, it's this long, about 6.5 hour journey up about 250 miles to the International Space Station to lay ground for a new mission or a new contraption or something that they're putting up there. And right now, there's two astronauts up there communicating back to Houston about what they're doing. Kind of cool to see this live up there in space and bring it back down for you. Figured it was pretty interesting as we sort of veer away from coverage on Capitol Hill, but we'll bring you whatever's happening live as it happens. Stay with us here on Fox 5 Live.
That one's done. I'm at the bag now.
I'm on the other side of the bag.
Yeah, okay. These are all done. There may be some down towards like 4 o'clock, but I'm not sure about 4 to 6.
I got all those down there.
Good, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so great. I think we're good. At around from like 9... I don't know if there's anything needed there. It looks pretty flat to me.
I got one at like 7 or 8, and
okay.
I don't know what else is there. But
okay, let's get this one. Right.
Where you at?
Right.
This
here.
Guy?
Yeah, if you can get that one on that still. Yeah.
This one here.
This way.
I
wrap around one more time,
yeah,
thing?
Yeah, and then I'll take the slack up.
Yeah, I think it.
Come on.
You'll have to, like, turn it 180 to get the stick.
Go reach this.
Reach.
Okay.
Good.
Got it.
I'm going to rat here. Rat. Egg.
Okay.
And even though we don't know exactly what they're doing, because we're not astronauts or necessarily educated on space talk, this is cool because NASA will have cut-ins in Houston at their headquarters, at their base, Johnson Space Center, and they'll have spokespeople there to kind of talk about what's going on. You can kind of see the NASA grounds and offices and the headquarter base. So right now we're getting sort of this shoddy feed of what's going on in the expedition, but then shortly, sometimes they'll cut it in back to Houston. So we'll see. We'll look out for one of those. And if we have anything new and breaking and anything exciting, I'll bring that to you as well. Thanks, guys, for watching.
A view from the helmet camera of astronaut Shane Kimbrough as he works with Peggy Whitson to tie down the pressurized mating adapter cover as an axial shield. Very reminiscent of Apollo 13 days where if something goes wrong, teams get together and retrofit a solution and come up with a way to still accomplish the goal. The crew is in no immediate danger. However, coming up with this idea still provides micrometeoroid and thermal protection for that exposed portion of node 3 where the pressurized mating adapter used to be.
And for your next and after you get that bag buttoned up, we'd like you to make a good assessment on that PMA3 cover as best you can, particularly and mostly interested in the gap being covered up, the sealing surface being protected, and then an assessment on how secure you feel the cover is to station movements.
I think it's very secure to station motion. The sealing surface is completely covered. Let's see, that's where Sheen is. At 4 o'clock. And then down here at 4 o'clock, gap that I have as it goes over the CBM cover is no more than the gap next door on the CBM cover itself. So this side, I think, is nicely covered up, and it's multiple Velcro.
Yeah, guys, looks like they are just sort of speaking NASA lingo and working on some stuff there. I don't see any cut-ins down to the people down here in Houston who could talk to us or talk to their people and give us more information. So let's just jump it over to the Senate floor again. We'll get a little more action about what's going on Capitol Hill. The Senate Russia hearing on the Russian investigation. That's what we have coming in live right now. And we'll keep a watch for other things as they happen as well. So jumping over now to Washington, D.C., right here to Capitol Hill.
In cyber and information spaces, they have great propagandists and they have the best hackers that are out there that they can either enlist because they're criminals and sort of bring under their umbrella or train themselves. We, on the other hand, worry a lot about who we're going to bring into the cyber field because they might have smoked weed one day or they can't pass a security clearance or, you know, they didn't get a score on their ASVAB, But there's millions, I mean millions of talented Americans out there that can support these roles inside our government. We need to invest in humans moving forward in this space. And it's hard to get Americans to understand that, or even the Department of Defense, because you're talking about cyber and computers, and so you think of tech. But the truth is that tech only works if you've got the smartest brains behind it. We do, but we don't put them against our fight.
Thank you. Dr. Roemer.
I think we should be careful using terms such as an act of war. It's definitely a continuation of warfare by other means. Mm-hmm. But, you know, when you declare something to be an act of war, it calls for certain responses that we may not be ready to take on. I do agree with Mr. Watts on the need to be much more creative and much more resourceful in a way we approach the question of, call it cyber warfare. Again, would caution that, you know, the Russians have a very different standard here in using their offensive tools than we use in using our cyber tools with a great deal of responsibility. And I think we should be very careful not to cross certain lines. We should, however, be using tools that are available to us and platforms that are available to us just from a somewhat, you know, different domain. I think that our own spokesman, our own information projected, delivered from our platforms should be the gold standard of accuracy and objectivity. So from that standpoint, let me just say that, you know, we're not using, for example, the platform of the State Department effectively. The practice of not sustaining our regular briefings for the media, for the world, is something that only hurts our interests.
Thank you.
I agree with my colleagues, so I won't repeat the same conclusions they reached. I would, though, like to introduce the idea, though, that cyber is now important. Cyber wasn't considered so important 20 years ago, now considered important. But there are other technologies coming on board now. Some are visible to us. They're not very salient. They haven't risen above the horizon. There are a whole number of technologies that are not internet dependent. And as we look at active measures now and into the future, I would think that would be on the agenda. I'll give just one example, virtual reality. Anybody who can set up the reality is going to have a very decided advantage in politics and other areas. And so as we're looking at cyber, and you are going to have a hearing and other studies of this, I would say just that we should broaden.
We're going to jump right back to NASA because there's a guy kind of explaining some stuff, Gary Jordan at NASA headquarters. This should be kind of interesting. Let's go right back.
Scheduled EVA and go to get the cummerbunds. This is going to be another thing that will be installed onto the pressurized mating adapter. Cummerbunds provide a little bit of protection as well as a snug fit for the pressurized mating adapter. Again, moved from that old location where it was at node 3, now on the top, the space facing side of node 2. This will provide a little bit more protection. There it is right there. Cummerbund is a very apt name for this sort of hardware.
So just a little explanation as to what you're seeing. Gary just sort of spelled it out there in Houston. Try to bring more of that to live as we, if we get more information on what's going on up at this International Space Station Expedition 50.
Okay with that bike thing?
Which is proving to be pretty cool. I think it's pretty interesting footage and something you don't always see. We'll jump it back to the Senate in just a moment here.
Investigation. As you look at the emails that were captured either out of the DNC or out of the Podesta account that were then the source of Russia's effort through WikiLeaks to publicly lay this out, that seemed to be an average, ordinary Russian fishing expedition that we captured maybe 3,000 efforts at the same period in time. So Are you suggesting that they had an effort to mess with the elections and just happened to be lucky enough to stumble across a volume of emails?
They go widespread. Whatever are the best nuggets that come out of that is what they run with. They hit a gold mine, and they were able to successfully find the ammunition they wanted. What you see at other cases is they do compromise other accounts. I'm not going to talk about them. I don't want to amplify them, but they're less successful. You know, we'll hear dumps, and you'll be like, oh, this isn't really anything other than what I expected a politician to say. And so they hit a whale whenever they went fishing. But I would also say that somewhere in their cache right now, there's tremendous amounts of information laying around that can weaponize against other Americans.
We would agree with you on that. And very quickly, as you sort of summarized how fake news and how coordinated social media efforts push stories to the top 10 and they get picked up automatically, what is the takeaway for U.S. media outlets from what you've just said?
They have to improve their editorial processes, and they also have to take a step back from the "I got to get it out first" competitive environment. Part of the reason this Russian system works is every outlet races to get the story out first. When they do that, they put themselves at risk to fall for these sorts of schemes. And until they improve that, or until they collectively, we have some sort of standard that either the public or the media holds to itself, we're going to keep seeing them fall for these campaigns, whether it's Russia, by the way, or others.
Sure.
You're going to see many other nations take this on now. The playbook's been thrown out there.
Dr. Rumer, would you like to take the opportunity to address in greater detail what the Russians are doing in the French and German elections?
There's a wide effort in the German election to build up this far-right party, Alternative for Germany, ADF, to use them as sort of a credible challenger to Chancellor Angela Merkel. There are countless stories that are being spread through fake news sites, proliferating the media about you know, the failures of Chancellor Merkel. They, as others have pointed out, have exploited the story about the girl that was not raped, but to again discredit her in the eyes of the general public, so as to you know, point out her failure to protect Germany against the flood of refugees. That's one of the major policy initiatives that she took when the Syria crisis broke out. In the French election, we just saw something that really was staggering, and that is President Putin hosted in the Kremlin the leading far-right candidate, and almost with a smirk said that we don't interfere in French elections, but we have the right to engage any candidate in the public domain in that contest. Russian disinformation sources have spread malicious stories about one of the leading candidates, Emmanuel Macron, about his personal life. So
for the first time, we're really beginning to see an effort to build up and to absolutely destroy the character of others, having a double impact on the potentially on the outcome of the election.
Yes, sir.
Good. Dr. Godson, just quickly, how did we respond differently when we overcame these active measures by Russians pre-80? And is there a lesson for us to learn from that in our actions now?
I think there are a number of lessons, but one was this exposure business that we learned how to put out information into the public domain that not only was relevant for Americans but for foreigners. And we briefed that, and we developed teams that could go out and talk about these things and so neutralize a lot. That was one of the methods that we could replicate. A second was support to elements abroad who are trying to maintain the democratic process. We developed some capabilities to do that. We still have some. One of the outstanding examples is the National Endowment for Democracy, bipartisan, able to do quite a lot, but is also limited in various ways. And so one could look back and see how we were able to do this in different ways abroad that had an effect in the past. It's not that expensive. Financially.
Sure.
And those methods are available.
Thank you. Mr. Watts, just very briefly, has anybody taken you up on your list of recommendations?
No.
Okay. That did not go unnoticed by the committee. I want you to know that. And
thank you.
Nor did the comment that there was agreement on at the table that America's response to date has been woefully short of what it should be. If anything, it should be interpreted, and probably was interpreted by the Russians, that they can double down and, in fact, do it unscathed. So, Mr. Watts, we heard you when you said fact and fiction have become wildly blurred. Let me just assure you that this...
Once again, guys, just to check in, you're watching on the Senate floor here, the Senate Intelligence Committee, which opened its first public hearing on the possible Russian meddling with the United States election. That started today, Thursday. Today, this is the first public hearing of that nature. Senator Burr there, North Carolina, he actually went to my alma mater. Wake Forest grad. I remember learning about him when I was there in college, so I'm familiar with him and where his office is, but Chairman Burr there kind of speaking to them, and if you've been listening, sort of what we know so far is that what we're hearing is that Russian interference with American politics did not stop after the election, that there's still things in the midst. So we'll keep on this, because this is what we're getting live on Capitol Hill right now. Thank you for watching Fox 5 Live, guys.
To build an investigation on that foundation that can hopefully come to a bipartisan finding where the conclusions are matched with the facts that we find. In some cases, as all three of you know, that might be intelligence product that can't be made public. But in every place that we can, I have pledged to the vice chairman, and he has pledged to his members, and I have pledged to mine, where we can make it public so that the American people understand it and feel that this has been credible and thorough and that the conclusions are valid, we're going to try to do that. But I also believe that the American people expect us to protect sources and methods. They expect us to work with the intelligence community in a way that strengthens what they do and how they do it, not by sharing that with everybody, but by certifying that they're doing it within the letter of the law to keep America safe. I look at this investigation as one extension of that, and it's to once again certify to the American people what we've done. It's been thorough, to hopefully provide some actionable conclusions for this administration, and to look back on the work that we do and believe that in 2018, 2020, we're going to be less concerned with Russia's involvement in our elections, and that the United States of America should, like we do on terrorism, work with any country in the world that might be the target of an aggressor like Vladimir Putin. So I'm grateful to you for what you've contributed to our investigation. This hearing's now adjourned.
Pretty good. That's interesting. Almost
through. All right, guys, and that was the end of it.
We're going to step away from the bump shot of the Capitol Dome, take you down to New Braunfels, Texas.
All right, guys, taking a moment there just to switch gears. We're going to go over right down to New Braunfels, Texas. There's a press conference now for the bus accident that happened earlier when the bus accident collided with a tractor trailer, I want to say. We're going to bring you there now as they're setting up, and they will give more details on what happened and the fallout from that.
Probably most of the day. But we want to take care of you the best we can. So, okay? All right?
Okay. My name is Brad McLean. Stole to spell it and all that. So B-R-A-D, last name McLean, M-C, capital L-E-A-N. And I am senior pastor here at First Baptist Church, New Braunfels. I first want to thank our New Braunfels community. So many in our community, businesses, other churches have reached out to us. They're providing food for us. They're providing support for us, counseling for our church family. And I'm terribly grateful for the outpouring of love that our community has shown during this difficult time for us. Our hope as a church is that we make much of Jesus during this time. Many might ask the question, why would God allow this to happen? I can't answer that question. But I am confident of this. I am confident of God's perfect plan. I am confident that the Lord numbered the days of these individuals, and we trust that completely. I know these individuals had confessed Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their life for the forgiveness of their sin, for the salvation of their soul, and they love their Lord. And we know that our Lord loved them. And so we don't rest in what we do not know. We just rest in who God is. And that's where we find our strength and confidence during this time. Our priority as a church in these days is to care for our families who've lost a loved one in this accident. We want to take care of them. We want to help them through these difficult days. There will be services being planned and prepared, and as a church family, that's what we will step in and help them do during this difficult time. I also encourage people to pray for the family of the driver of the other vehicle. That family is hurting. I encourage that we show grace to them. We pray for them and show love for them as they work through a very difficult time as well. So that's what I have to say. So if you want to begin.
For those who may not understand why you just said what you just said about the why do that? Why are you reaching out now to family and this person?
Well, those families are people. And they have love in their heart. They have a concern for their family member. They're hurting for the loss of life that occurred yesterday. And so as believers in Christ, we need to show them grace and pray for them as well because of what they are suffering.
What can you tell us about this group, where they were going, and what their trip was about?
They were on their way home. They had a retreat where they spent some time together in Bible study, playing games, fellowship. It's a nice encampment where they were, and so they were just on their way home.
Said he wanted to leave it to the family to talk about them individually, but as a group, what did this group mean for the church? I mean,
Is this a particularly tight-knit group? Is this a choir or anything? How involved with this group?
Well, the individuals who were on that trip, those are individuals we see. You know, I see their face weekly. They're engaged in other activities of ministry. Some have been members here for many years and have gone on mission trips with First New Braunfels. And you know, these are individuals we've sat next to and had dinner with and laughed with and cried with and worshiped with. So you know, they were part of our church family. So they will be deeply missed as members of our church family.
Pastor, the names were released this morning. As you saw those names last night, one would think you would think of some memories or some good times that you had with some of those individuals. Are you able to kind of, you don't have to name their names, but are you able to kind of describe the personalities, maybe some specific memories from some of these individuals?
I do. I remember the smiles. I remember the hugs. I remember, you know, I remember the couples coming in together, and you see them together, you know, all the time. I remember so many walking by and saying, "Pastor, we're praying for you. Pastor, thank you for what you do." You know, you live life. You live life with folks, and so you just share so many small interactions. You know, that add up to relationship that impacts you and strengthens your heart. Yeah.
Elders are always cherished in churches and congregations. Mm-hmm. Like this. So many of them.
Well, there's the shock, and there's the sadness, you know, that comes with that. We have a fantastic senior adult ministry, there's the hard reality of. We won't see those faces walking in the door and being able to greet them and shake hands and hug them and see some out of that group who served in our kitchen on Wednesday nights. And so it's those, I think it's the everyday interaction and relationship that has been built that, boy, those are the things that really, really will affect us, you know, a week from now, a month from now, a year from now.
What have you been hearing from the others at the retreat who didn't get on the bus? How are they handling the loss?
Honestly, I haven't heard much. They're saddened, and they're heartbroken. They have said what an incredible 3 days they had. They worshiped together. They shared testimony together. They opened God's word together. And they've just said it was an incredible 3 days.
Was this a group that would normally, because this group was together on the bus, was this group a group that would kind of do things as a group? Did they do like Bible study classes?
Well, yeah, some were involved in Sunday school classes together, but you know, the whole of the group was 60 plus people who went, and this was just the little group who rode the bus.
60.
I don't know the exact number, but it was
65. How big is your church?
I don't. We have about, you know, 550 show up on a Sunday morning. We're running a lot more. We're running a lot more. We only catch about 550, if that makes sense.
Is there anything people can do to help?
So many people already are helping. You know, I mentioned the community, businesses, We've had a number of restaurants last night who started bringing food over. We've had offers from grocery stores and other restaurants today to help come and bring food. So many churches are rallying around. I see Rip Hardaway, pastor of the church next door, is here, and St. Paul Lutheran Church came over last night with a group of their folks. Oakwood Baptist Church has been here and been on site with ministry staff. So I've received emails from all over the country. So many people are helping and praying and providing material things just to help us care for our families through this time. I don't have an update yet.
Have you been to the scene of the accident?
No, sir. It's 2 hours, 2.5 hours from here. So, I don't know at this time. I don't know at this time.
Have you thought at all about what your sermon is going to be about on Sunday?
Yes, I've thought a great deal about that. We're still working to put that time together because we are not sure how we approach that. We know that as we always attempt to do every Sunday is to make much of Jesus and point people to Jesus Christ through what we sing, through the preaching of God's word. But how we approach that at this moment, we're just still not, we're still working through that, still praying through that. Oh, sure. Family members of those who, yes. Most of them were here last night. And our church family did what church families are supposed to do. Lots of prayer, lots of support for those families. Lots of crying with those families. Because we're, you know, we live, we work together. I mean, we worship together. Our children have, you know, they're friends, and some of our families are very, very close to one another. And so our church family is doing what we should do and coming together and grieving with those who grieve and weeping with those who are weeping because they've suffered loss and we hurt with them. We haven't received any information regarding her at the moment. We love her. We're praying for her. Fully hope and expect that we will see her beautiful smiling face back in our choir very soon.
I think that's good. Thank you all very much for your time. Thank you.
You want one? We can do one more. Yeah, one more. I would ask that you contact the families before you do that and get their permission. I don't feel we have the responsibility to release those, I believe we may be compiling a list of media outlets and then providing those to the families so that they can contact you if they choose to do so. We want to be respectful of them. All right, thank you.
All right, guys, we're going to bring you out of that. And some of you might be wondering what exactly this is all about. I know I didn't preface this as we jumped right into this press conference, but clearly a very tough thing, a very emotional case for that pastor, the details of which are this. Yesterday, Wednesday afternoon, there was a bus returning from a senior retreat, so senior adults attending this retreat about 75 miles west of San Antonio, when there was a head-on crash with this bus and a pickup truck, they're saying, near the state park called Garner State Park. It happened around noon, just a little bit after noon. And I'm going to bring you out of that. And essentially, we heard, what we're reading is that, according to the AP, 13 people were killed in the crash. Now, there were 14 passengers and one driver. 13 of those passengers, those senior adults, were killed in the crash. And one other is listed in stable condition. I believe that's the woman that he was referencing at the end of that press conference when he talked about someone, I think, questioned this woman and if she would be returning to church. So the truck driver himself is a 20-year-old male, who is in stable condition right now. But again, 13 of those 14 passengers were killed in this crash. Really, a really, really sad emotional press conference, a really big tragedy, I believe, for this church community. So that's sort of the background on that. That happened yesterday afternoon. And we just got alerted to this press conference that the pastor was giving. So that's that. A few more minutes to go here on the show, so we're going to kind of wrap it up, but bring you over back to the Senate. But a stakeout camera is in the hallways as the Senate is kind of in the middle of their meetings, and they previously adjourned that other hearing. And now you can kind of check out a live behind the scenes what it looks like as this camera stakes out the Senate hallways. Let's go over there.
When you rest, you can put some of that pressure down here, and you can let go. Not for long, but
NBC.
Dude, 65 bucks.
So, but you gotta have the piece that goes in the Sony wedge.
No, this is the same wedge for Sony, Panasonic.
Exactly. Well, that's what I mean is that you screw it in, or does it clip?
It's clip straight, like, just like a tripod.
Okay, that's what I mean.
Yeah.
What'd you say, 65?
I'll give you, I did all the research.
Yeah. I'll be an agent. Oh, I'll look them up.
I did all the research, and I did my research based on the guys who were with them, what they told me they like and what they don't. Now, the only difference in this is,
and just cut in here, guys. Just want to thank you guys for joining us. We're happy to have people watching. We like to kind of bring different feeds from all around DC and, of course, the nation. Just breaking news, breaking events, keep you up to date with stuff that's happening around everywhere in the country and in the world, just so you're up to date and you find it interesting and you can stay sort of abreast of the news and the important things that are happening in our world. So you're looking at live pictures of the Senate hallways, little stakeout cam there before they continue on with the hearing. That's what it looks like. Those low, dark ceilings, or dark hallways, low ceilings in the building there. And, of course, these are all live raw feeds, so what you hear, what you might see, sort of the jostling of the camera, that's perfectly natural. Just going to bring it to you live so that you get the truth. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. We're happy to have you join us and chat with us on YouTube. We're streaming here on YouTube midday. I usually start around 11, go for the sort of that mid-afternoon slot. And as breaking news happens, you might find us on here earlier or later. But keep with us, and we'd love to hear what you think. Don't forget, you can always follow me or contact me. I'm Molly Nevola here. My handle on Twitter and Instagram, at Molly Nevola. And our show is Fox 5 Live. Fox 5 DC is our handle on all platforms with the channel here that you see behind me. So I'm in this little basement studio in my own little room with all these screens in front of me that you can't see right now. But if I get a camera up behind me, I will show you what is going on in front of me. But we are in DC, live picture there of the Capitol. Gorgeous picture of the Capitol, and also the White House, if you want to check it out. That's a live shot of the White House. Not too much wind going on today. You don't see that flag moving too much. But yeah, we'll leave it here, and I'll bring you some more stuff as I close out the show in just a few moments here. Our stakeout cam is gone, so it's perhaps they're going to feed us something new. So we'll be right back in just a moment. It looks like they are questioning, I believe it's Marco Rubio in the hallways there. We're going to bring that to you.
To undermine individuals, to undermine our elections,
And hacking emails is one of the tactics they use, and then strategically placing it in the media. But another is the creation of either exaggerations or flat out untrue stories, whether it is to undermine a person or to sow instability or chaos or to pit people against each other. And I hope that's what the report will focus on as well, because that's not going to end. That's going to keep happening, and they're going to keep getting better at it.
But do you think there's anything, do you think there's anything actually that you can think of that they use specifically, fake news that was spread that really caught on that could have hurt you in the campaign?
I've never talked to him about that before. It's the first time I meet that gentleman. His testimony was very good, but as I said, I mean, that's not something.
So you've never seen any evidence that you've never
seen. En español no puede decir de la importancia de esta investigación y vamos a saber qué es lo que pasó.
Bueno, la investigación no es solamente sobre lo que pasó con los correos electrónicos de Hillary Clinton, sino también se trata más ampliamente de este esfuerzo de parte del gobierno de Vladimir Putin de influenciar las elecciones y el debate público en este país y en otros lugares. Obviamente ellos utilizaron correos electrónicos que se robaron como parte de esa estrategia, pero también la creación de información falsa para tratar de dividir y crear problemas políticos dentro de los diferentes países, incluso este. Así que es importante entender eso porque va a seguir ocurriendo.
So, is this the first time that you've learned that you may have been impacted by?
I don't really have any further comment for you guys about what he said. I'm entirely focused on not just what happened, but what's going to continue to happen. The American people deserve to know not just what happened, but these tactics, this propaganda warfare that's ongoing, and how they themselves, the American people, are being, there's an effort to manipulate them and to pit us against each other through the introduction of false news and also through the strategic leaking of stolen information. And I also think, by the way, and I don't mean this in a mean-spirited way, but I also think it's important for all of us, those of us who participate in the political debate and those of you who cover it, to kind of re-examine the role that we are all playing in these debates and in how we use information, especially when it's inaccurate.
So it doesn't sound like you were surprised by him saying that.
I don't really have any comment about what he said in particular. This is an important work that we're doing here, and I want to focus on that work.
What do you think is the main motive of Russian hacking in the American election?
I think it goes beyond the American elections. It has multiple motives to further their strategic aims, whether it's make the argument that American democracy is not legitimate, whether it's undermining particular leaders that they believe are unfriendly to their interests, whether it's to sow instability as they've pit Americans against each other, whether it's false stories about police shootings or, in essence, as the gentleman testified, they use things like Ferguson. They also use things, and not like Occupy Wall Street, legitimate movements in America, people that were upset about something, but then they try to amplify on that and exacerbate it in the hopes of then being able to report back to the world and to their own people that America's a disaster. So it's not new, but they now have the internet and technology that they can use to rapidly spread exaggerated news and sometimes false news in a way that furthers their aims, undermining individual leaders they believe are unfriendly to their interests, and also undermining the United States, the democratic order, and of course now you're seeing that in France and in Germany.
Did it trouble you to hear that Paul Manafort and Trump may have used active measures to hurt Hillary Clinton in coordination with Russians? Clinton Watts suggested that.
Yeah, well, I'm not going to comment on any particular testimony until the report is finished and we can issue that. And we'll put on that report, I hope, facts. And not just opinions, but facts. I'm not disputing. I'm not accepting anything anyone's saying. We're in the process of undertaking all of that. And I continue to believe that it's going to take a little while, but we need to do this right because this is not going to end. This did not stop in November 2016. This is going to be an ongoing challenge for America and the world for years to come.
Do you know if you've ever been hacked? Have you been hacked before? Have you ever been told that you've been hacked?
Yeah, I'm not going to comment on any of those things.
Why not? Is it because you've been briefed on this or?
I generally don't comment on matters involving the Intelligence Committee until the report is issued, and we'll let that speak for itself. I got to run after this guy's having a meeting.
Policy-wise, is Trump able to counter some of these active measures by Russia? Do you have confidence that he'll do that?
Well, I think it's in our interest as a country to do that, and let's first get through this report. We'll also, I hope, issue recommendations about policy changes, and hopefully the White House and the administration will be supportive.
La motivación de Rusia para intervenir en las elecciones de Estados Unidos.
Well, they're best done professionally and through the proper process, not via press statements or press conferences. But we're going to have a report. It's going to be public, and you guys will get to read it and see it and opine on it, and the American people will be informed by it.
So you don't want to rule out tax returns?
I just want to continue to do the work we are doing, and I ask you guys to be patient. We're going to do it right, and so that way this will be an issue that will have definitive opinions and definitive facts that you can base news stories on. But I understand you. Everyone's in, you know, you guys are tasked with the job of reporting news every night. I don't blame you for it, but we are tasked with putting this together right, and I think we've learned in the last couple of weeks that sometimes these things are best done without kind of a daily statements in the press about every detail of it.
Why do you think Trump continues to insist that the news about Russian hacking is false news?
Again, we're going to continue to work on the stuff that we're working on here in this investigation. You'll have to direct any questions about the White House to the White House.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, guys. Sorry to bring you all the way over.
The White House continues to say, and the president continues to say, that the Russia story is just a hoax. What do you hope they're learning today?
Well, I would hope the administration would be listening to these experts and what was, I think, the unanimous assessment of the Intelligence Committee members from both sides, that Russia massively intervened. They used selective hacking of information from the DNC and John Podesta, that they use the very technology that we all use to get the news out in ways that were creative, but also, I think, inherently destructive to our electoral process. The use of these internet trolls and botnets and false information, and I think you heard from one of the individuals, Mr. Watts, that in many ways that misinformation campaign was aided at times by then candidate Trump repeating some of these stories that were groundless.
He said specifically part of the reason active measures have worked in this election is because the commander-in-chief has used Russian active measures at times against his opponents. Does that move you closer to the idea that there could have been some improper coordination between the Trump campaign
these
and
these are
Russians?
All the questions. These are some of the core questions we have to get to. I mean, this afternoon's hearing, you know, I'm going to try to drill down on the technology capability to actually target by precinct certain voters. Now, what I've been told is that the Russian intel services alone would not have that level of political sophistication about our electoral process to know which precinct in Wisconsin, which precinct in Michigan to target. So where did they get that information? And, you know, again, I'm not sure we'll get an answer this afternoon, but it's, you know, obviously one area of the inquiry.
Two of your colleagues, Feinstein and Wyden, have said that it would be important to get the president's tax returns to determine any financial links. Well, do you think that's important? Will you try to subpoena them?
I have been actively calling long before this investigation started for the president to do what every other prior president and every other prior presidential candidate has done, which is release their tax returns. I still hold that position. Listen, we're going to work on this in a bipartisan fashion. We're going to follow the intel where it leads. I take the chairman at his word, and if we'll see where that leads.
Are you sure that you will have the answer?
All right, guys, with that, that is going to round out our show today. I want to thank you guys so much for joining. Thanks for chatting with us live on the stream, too. We're going to be bringing this to you live every day, every weekday, and continue to see what type of engagement you guys want to hear, what you want to talk about, what you guys think. It's kind of cool getting those behind-the-scenes hallway grabs of the senators and what they think, and those reporters are going to use that information on their later shows. So it's, I think it's neat to kind of get it in the moment, that behind the scenes look on Capitol Hill. But we want to bring you all different types of news, from aerial cameras of alligators to, you know, Capitol Hill. Of course, we have a lot of politics stuff, President Trump stuff, even the White House press briefing, if that usually falls in line. We don't have that till later today, but we'll bring that to you live whenever we have it live. So with that, I'm just going to close it out, guys. I am Molly Nevola. It's great to be chatting with you and to hear from you today. And we will see you another time when you join us for the show. I'm going to leave you with a cool picture of the White House, that live shot of the White House going up right here. See you tomorrow, guys.